Hey guys, it's Dani. As I promised you yesterday, today we're gonna talk about how to recognize orchid genera when they don't have any flowers. We're not gonna talk about a whole lot of them obviously, but just the most popular ones that you can find in flower shops. And this is a subject that somebody actually suggested because many of us want to purchase discounted orchids which don't have blooms anymore. However, when it comes to recognizing what they could be when they don't have flowers, well, it can get a little tricky. So today we're just gonna look at the most common orchids you can find in flower shops, and I'll show you a few pointers to look out for when you're trying to determine what type of orchid it could be. This is a more of a beginner type of video. I'm sure many of you already are able to recognize them without any type of trouble, and I'm not referring here to the particular orchid, but the family, let's call it like that. But I hope you will find this interesting, so without further ado, let's get to work. Let's start with, the Phalaenopsis. So I won't linger all that much on Phalaenopsis because by now most of us know how they look like. They're those very, very big orchids which seem to produce quite broad leaves, which can get very, very long. The leaves are always arranged opposite to each other, and in the middle we have a central stem. The stem is what produces the leaves, the roots, and also the flower spikes. The roots are thick, fleshy, many of them do produce a lot of aerial roots, and if you don't know what those are, check the description, I'll link you down below to a video on it. And as you might know, some orchids might have more or less roots, but pretty much any Phalaenopsis will look something very, very similar. If you are in a part of the world which sometimes brings some unusual Phalaenopsis, do check the color and the pattern on the leaves. Typically, whatever has quite a lot of Polychilus subgenus in its parentage, and yet again, if you don't know what this is, check the description down below. It is a trait that a summer bloomer has, actually. So if you find a Phalaenopsis which tends to be super, super light, well, you might be in luck. Maybe that Phalaenopsis is close more to the Polychilus genus. It might actually be fragrant. It might be unusual. Keep in mind, don't mistake a lighter color to something like sunburn or the orchid dying. You have to look at the root system, the stem, and pretty much all of the leaves, and everything should be relatively healthy. If you only have one single leaf on top of the orchid and everything is gone, then chances are that orchid is not a Polychilus hybrid, but just sick. If you find something that looks like a Phalaenopsis but has a pattern, mottling, freckles, something you've never seen on a Phalaenopsis leaf before, well, again, there is a chance that orchid is something special. Again, don't mistake patterns for fungal spots. With disease spots, you will notice them. They don't look very appealing. Sometimes they're sunken in. Sometimes they're surrounded by a yellow halo or a circle. Those are unhealthy orchids, but something like this is actually a species. Paphiopedilums, also known as slipper orchids or lady slipper orchids, are much less common than Phalaenopsis in flower shops, but from time to time you will find them. In Europe at least, these are the most famous ones. This is a Maudier type and this is the American hybrid. Now these orchids do look like Phalaenopsis, if you look at the actual orchids themselves. As you noticed, the green one has mottled leaves, while the other one has green leaves. Without flowers, you might actually mistake them for Phalaenopsis, so let's just take a closer look at them. Paphiopedilums have leaves opposite to each other as well, just like a Phalaenopsis, but there is no central axis. They look more like fans than anything else. Also, if you look on top of the medium, you will not see any aerial root. Paphiopedilums are not epiphytes. They're typically terrestrials or lithophytes, but definitely they grow in a much, much different environment. Everything is under the medium, or at least it should be. If you see anything exposed ever, it should be a fuzzy brown root. And that is not a dead root, that's normal for paphiopedilums. If you'll find such a paphiopedilum in flower shops without a flower, look for the stem in the center of the fan. This is where paphiopedilums bloom from, unlike Phalaenopsis orchids. So if you see remains of a flower spike right in the center, well, that's most probably a paphiopedilum. But again, you have to correlate it with all of the other features because sometimes you might actually find a terminal spike Phalaenopsis. But if you compare the two plants, it is actually quite easy to tell them apart. Now, paphiopedilums are very, very different, and in my opinion, they are better suited for beginners because they do resemble houseplants, being that they are terrestrial. They're not so prone to having all sorts of root issues such as the phalaenopsis. I do have a tutorial on these very, very easy hybrids. Check it down below in the description. Keep in mind, there are a lot of varieties, and it really depends on the flower shop how lucky you are. Sometimes you will find all sorts of patterns on paphiopedilum leaves, but more about paphs in the description. Next up, cattleyas, which are again some of the most diverse group of orchids that you can find in flower shops. And just like the paphiopedilums, they're just not as common as phalaenopsis, but this of course will depend on the region. Now, cattleyas are definitely nothing like phalaenopsis if we take a look at the orchids. These are sympodial orchids, meaning they don't produce a central stem, but rather a rhizome, which produces growths. All of these growths are part of the very same plant. Paphiopedilums were sympodials as well, but their rhizome is very tiny, and also they don't produce pseudobulbs or canes, which is the name of these formations which you see under the leaves. Cattleyas typically produce slender, tall pseudobulbs that are connected through the rhizome, and on top they produce leaves. Most cattleyas produce one or two leaves on top. We call them unifoliate and bifoliate, but there are some hybrids with quite a few leaves on top, 3, 4, even 5. Most commonly though, you will find cattleyas with one or two leaves. The pseudobulbs can vary. Some pseudobulbs have natural ridges, some are more plump, some are a little rounder, but they all pretty much are elongated rather than round. Cattleyas typically bloom on top of the canes, so if you see a discounted orchid which looks like a cattleya, look on top of the canes. Some of them will have previous sheaths or remains of flower spikes which were cut. Also, in many, many cases, these pseudobulbs have some sort of sheaths on them which are dry. Typically, they fall off on their own, but cattleyas are known for these sheaths, which you can actually pull off when they're dry. When it comes to roots, cattleyas can actually have aerial roots. They typically have white roots, but it's not something to differentiate them from because many orchids produce very, very similar type of roots, even identical roots, such as dendrobiums, which are the next group of orchids we're gonna talk about. And many people actually confuse cattleyas with dendrobiums. On the market, there are two very, very common dendrobiums, the so-called Dendrobium phalaenopsis and the nobili. So I'm gonna take them separate because they're different. I'm gonna start with the Dendrobium phalaenopsis because people actually confuse the cattleya with this dendrobium. Dendrobium phalaenopsis orchids produce elongated pseudobulbs as well. We call them canes, and definitely they are rather long and slender, just like in the case of the cattleya. However, if you look at the leaves, you will notice that they are actually produced on each side of the cane, and there are multiple leaves on each cane. Cattleyas typically only produce a few leaves on top of the cane. This is the major difference between the Dendrobium phalaenopsis and the cattleyas. Also, these orchids can produce flower spikes on top of the canes, but also in between the leaves. And with these orchids, the older canes can rebloom again, for a few years even. When it comes to roots, both of these orchids have identical roots. They're white with a green tip. Both of these orchids can produce aerial roots, so the roots are not really an indication. I find them to be almost identical. With this type of dendrobium, the leaves are very, very sturdy, and you cannot really bend them all that easily. On some varieties you can, but definitely on others you are in danger of snapping the leaf. Now, the difference between this type of dendrobium and the nobili type is the flowering habit. So let's just take a look at a nobili now. Nobili dendrobiums also produce long, slender canes, and they also produce leaves on each side of this cane. However, the blooming habit is very, very different. Nobilis typically produce flowers along their canes, while the other dendrobium, did you notice, they produce a flower spike, very similar to the phalaenopsis orchid. Even though they're not related, that's why we call them Dendrobium phalaenopsis. So if these orchids are not in bloom, what signs do you look for? Well, of course, the remains of the flower spikes. In the case of the nobili, you can see remains of very, very tiny little flower spikes all across the stem. You will not see one or two flower spike remains coming from the very top. Also, the cane looks a little bit different. This one looks more fleshy, and also the leaves are a little flimsier. They're not as sturdy. If you try to bend them, you definitely can without any type of problem. And this is valid across the board with all nobili hybrids, even though there is again a lot of variety on the market. Now, people typically call the Phalaenopsis dendrobiums and others hard cane dendrobiums and nobili's soft cane dendrobiums. I prefer to stay very far away from these terms because they're very confusing. You might think that these canes are actually soft, which they're not. They're actually not very soft. Yes, they are slightly softer. This is not the bestest of example because it is a rather long dendrobium with very, very slender canes, but I do have a nobili with very thick canes, which are very, very hard to bend. So don't understand that these guys are super soft. They're not. Don't try to bend the canes. They can grow in a pendant nature, yes, but it doesn't mean their canes are super soft. So, just so you know, those ones are hard cane dendrobiums and these are soft cane dendrobiums, but it doesn't really mean all that much. Don't try to bend around the canes because depending on variety, you might actually snap them. What you can actually bend are the leaves. As I was saying, they're very flexible. Roots-wise, they look identical to the Dendrobium phalaenopsis and the cattleyas. So again, roots are not a clear indication here, but definitely the structure of the canes and the leaves, and of course the remains of the flower spikes are. Then we have the Oncidiums, which again are a very, very, very diverse group, so it will be very, very hard to tell what type of Oncidium you actually have, but I'll try to give you a few pointers. First of all, the Oncidiums are those orchids which have round pseudobulbs. Just like the cats, the dendrobiums, and the Paphiopedilums, they are sympodial. They produce a rhizome, and on that rhizome, the orchid produces new pseudobulbs periodically. Unlike the cattleya and dendrobium, this type of orchid produces round, plump, and sometimes very, very impressive pseudobulbs. Depending on variety, they can be slightly more slender or elongated, slightly chubbier. It really depends, but definitely there is a very, very big difference between them and the cattleyas and dendrobiums. Oncidiums typically produce two or three leaves on top of each pseudobulb and then a few leaves on each side of the pseudobulb. You can have three, four leaves on each side depending on variety. The spikes are typically produced from each side of the pseudobulbs. Some Oncidiums will produce two, some one, some even more than that. Very, very rarely will they produce a flower spike on top of the pseudobulb. And if you find a dried flower spike, which looks like it has been cut, then chances are you are dealing with an Oncidium type. Now, what type of Oncidium do you have? Well, that's a tricky one, but I'm gonna give you a few pointers. Meltonias and their hybrids, such as the Bellaras, typically have elongated pseudobulbs. They're not as tall as dendrobiums or cattleyas. They still have the oval shape to them, rather than a slender cane. But typically, these hybrids have a sort of teardrop shape to their pseudobulbs. Sometimes Brassias can have this shape as well, but Brassias are a little bit rounder. However, Brassia hybrids with Miltonias typically look like this. What I'm showing you now is actually a Bellara. Also, Miltonias and their hybrids tend to have a lighter color of the leaves and the pseudobulbs. Odontoglossum hybrids such as the Wilsonaras, Vilstacaras, and other former hybrids tend to have a rather rounder, plumper, and chubbier pseudobulb in comparison to the Miltonias. The size of the pseudobulb can vary depending on the hybrid. You can have Odontoglossum hybrids with tinier pseudobulbs and ones with pretty large pseudobulbs. Another giveaway is the color and pigmentation. Typically, Odontoglossum hybrids have a darker green color, and also often you can see some dark freckles on the very top of the leaves here or even on the pseudobulbs. Some Odontoglossums even have very, very dark, almost worrying looking like pseudobulbs. but that is actually typical pigmentation. So in this category, you can find the wild cats, which are easy hybrids to grow, the former called Monaras. Typically, the smaller the pseudobulb, the smaller the flower as well. But usually these types of orchids, in my experience, something with heavy odontoglossum heritage rather than Miltonia or Brassia. Miltoniopsis hybrids and even Miltoniopsis orchids themselves typically have a pretty distinct looking like pseudobulb. First of all, the color is very light, naturally. Second, they tend to be rather matte. I'm not sure if it's a correct way to say it, but in comparison to the other pseudobulbs, they really aren't as glossy. Although if you touch them, they're not really matte, but they just appear that way. They tend to be rather flat, but some Miltoniopsis can become quite plump. But again, in comparison to the other ones, they do appear to be rather different. Also, many Miltoniopsis orchids only have one single leaf on top of the pseudobulb. Their hybrids can inherit this trait as well, such as the Nelly Eiler. Root-wise, they all kind of look the same, so we're not gonna talk about the roots. And finally, we have the proper Oncidiums, which can vary in size, but they look very similar to the Odontoglossums. Some of them even have some freckling. What's different is the color. Usually, Oncidium orchids are lighter in color than the Odontoglossums. Nowadays, I know, everything is pretty much an Oncidium, with the exception of the Miltonia and Miltoniopsis, and maybe even Brassias, but Odontoglossums don't exist anymore, which is a shame. I hope they bring them back, because there is a very, very big difference care-wise between the Oncidiums and Odontoglossums. Some of them are cooler growers and they really don't do so great in hot temperatures. Some of them absolutely love heat, so there really is a difference. That is why I prefer to call all of these by their former names, by the Colmenaras, Wilsonaras, Vilstacaras, all of those, because they do mean something to me, which I talk about in other videos. Now it's not the time, but there we have it. Mind you, there could be so many variations between all of these orchids, so many hybrids and intergenerics, and it can be very difficult to determine what they are without flowers. I have issues many of the times. There are only a few that I know for a fact what they are when I look at them. But yeah, just keep in mind, these are just pointers, but you can always have surprises. And the last very common orchid we will talk about is the Vanda orchid. There are many other genera and even popular orchids, but we cannot really find them all that often in flower shops, and we're gonna be here until tomorrow. So let's just talk about the Vandas. These are monopodial orchids, just like the Phalaenopsis and unlike all of the others. So they share quite a lot of traits. First of all, the leaves are produced on each side of a central stem, just like the Phalaenopsis. But the growth habit is a little bit different. Phalaenopsis orchids have a tendency to lean over, while Vandas don't really have the same tendency and they prefer to grow upright. We do have a crown, a central stem, and a root system produced at the base. But typically, Vandas will not be potted. Usually you can find them for sale in those very big vases, or sometimes just bare-rooted with a tiny little black basket, and in very, very rare cases, a wooden basket, which is really, really nice. Maybe it comes with some sort of cocoa choir inside it as well. It really depends on the seller here. Flower spikes, just like Phalaenopsis, are produced from each side of the central stem. Care-wise, there is a very big difference between these orchids. I'll share with you my care tutorials down below, both for Phalaenopsis and for Vandas. Vandas tend to be the most expensive orchid at the flower shop, together with the Cymbidium, which we're not gonna talk about today. Cymbidiums are not my forte, and I don't really have a lot of them. And also, in some places, they are very, very rare. And there we have it. This is about it for today. Thank you so much for suggesting this. I hope it will help you out when you're buying your next discounted orchid. And yeah, let me know how it goes. Buying discounted orchids and rejuvenating them has actually taught me a lot more in a lot shorter period of time. So I am all for buying discounted orchids, giving them another chance, because typically what flower shops do is just compost them. They don't return them to the nursery. So if you can save one, then that would be great. If you cannot, that's okay, but I hope this video was helpful. And you know the drill, like or dislike this video below, subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As, and other fun orchid subjects. And if you like YouTube to notify you whenever I upload a new video, just turn on notifications for my channel. Also, if you're interested in my setup and what I use on a regular basis, I do list everything in the description. So with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!